You've taken the first step really towards your digital transformation. You have ignited a fire in your mind with a new idea. This idea could have been planted recently, or it could have been planted a few years ago. But really, the important thing is that the idea hasn't gone away, shouldn't go away, and you've taken a step towards that. The digital environment today, after decades of innovation in digital impressions, is getting harder and harder to ignore. We're going to look at this tonight, and we're going to hear from someone who can talk firsthand about their own digital journey within dentistry. So, for the agenda for tonight, we'll start shortly with an introduction of your three virtual hosts. We'll then look at other industries which went digital, apart from dentistry, which ended up changing our lives. And then we'll also look at how this trend is currently impacting dentistry. Our clinician for this evening is Dr. Martin Wanandaya. He will share his own experience of his, he's just waving at you there. He'll share his own experience of his own digital transformation with us all tonight, and tell us what embracing digital actually means for you in practice. We'll then come back to myself, where I'll give you a guide on picking the right scanner, what to look out for when you're making that decision. I'll also then be switching to the PrimeScan intraoral scanner, which I have beside me. I'll scan a model, which I'll then send directly to our lab technician who is joining us tonight, which is Steve Campbell. Steve will then take it away and show us what happens to our impression from his side. We'll then wrap up with a brief bit about Dents by Sirona as a company and what you can expect from us. And we'll then open up for any questions. We'll also hear a final word at the end from Martin and Steve on what something that they're currently working on. So please stay with us until the end. So let us begin. So just to introduce myself, I'm your host from Dents by Sirona. My name is Jack, and I'm the CAD/CAM specialist for London and the East of England. Not a clinician myself, but I do have the experience of working with clinicians on a daily basis that are also going through their own digital journeys. And I've worked with clinicians in every stage of that journey so far. I've currently been a specialist for over a year now and have been working with dentists at Dents by Sirona for over 4 years in other fields such as endodontics. I'm also joined by Dr. Martin Wanandaya, who is here to share his own experiences during his own digital transformation. Martin is a practicing dentist and owner of 10 Dental Facial in London. He delivers lectures internationally on all aspects of implant dentistry, as well as being a tutor. We are also joined by Steve Campbell from Nexus Dental Laboratory, which he opened in 2015, and he is currently the president of the Dental Laboratories Association and an executive committee member of the British Academy of Aesthetic Dentistry. So, would you like to say a quick hello, Martin and Steve?
Hello.
Hello, good evening.
Looking forward to talking to you later.
Thank you, guys. So, to warm up and to get us thinking in the right mindset for the evening, I'd like to play a quick 4 minute video that's got some quite eye-opening digital facts. So enjoy. I hope you find the video interesting. So that was quite interesting. Just during the course of that one video there, 5 million swipes on Tinder. Incredible. So with that, let's move on to part two, called Let's Talk Digital. So if you ask yourself what's currently happening in on industry today, observing industry trends is something we all have to do, regardless of our place in the industry. You know, if we're clinicians or manufacturers, it's the same. We have to recognize where our industry and where our business currently is and where it's due to go within the next few years. These are questions that have actually already been asked on a large scale in the UK by the BDIA, who release what they call a spotlight every other year. And in this spotlight, over 400 people in the UK, mainly dentists, were asked in 2019 which technology or equipment they have already purchased. And in the top three positions were digital sensors, practice management software, and intraoral cameras. Note that these cameras aren't actually scanners. And one of the questions, one of the next questions in the same survey was, what do you intend to buy in the next year leading into 2020? And the biggest percentage here was 22% who answered they were intending to purchase an intraoral scanner as their next purchase. This again was next to intraoral cameras as the next biggest segment there, which is different, but that camera function is also something that most scanners can actually do. Then in a global study conducted by Dentsply Sirona in our largest global markets, which were the US, Germany and Japan, we asked nearly 900 dentists about five developments in digital dentistry, which were most important. Intraoral scanners were again in the lead there with 62%. They were then asked when they intended to purchase the digital a digital impression system for their practice, and more than 60%. Sorry about that, guys. How long was I muted for then?
Got to more than 60%.
Couple of minutes.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that. So yeah, if we combine the top three results there, more than 60% said that they were looking to purchase this equipment within the next 5 years. So what we can see from this information is that the dental industry globally is moving this way. This isn't just a UK or Europe focused trend in dentistry. Globally, the dental industry is moving this way. So I'm not sure how surprising these numbers are to everyone. But yeah, it does put into perspective what's happening on a global scale within dentistry. And it really is a digital revolution. So on that note, I would like to hand over to Dr. Martin Wanandaya. So he's already moved forwards with his own digital transformation. And he's here tonight to tell you all about it. So please take it away, Martin.
Okay. Excuse me for a second. Thank you very much, Jack, for handing that over to me. What I'm just gonna do is just share my screen with you. This is desktop 2, share that. Apologies, just a small technical hitch there. Let me just try that again. Share. Right. Just need to check what you're seeing at the moment, Jack. Are you seeing the presentation? Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, Jack, for the introduction. It's a pleasure to be here with you this evening to talk about digital. It's something that I'm very passionate about. And actually, what's quite nice is I'm here talking to you with one of the people who I started this journey with, who's Steve, who's been instrumental, I think, in my development in digital. And it's a real honor to speak with him and also for you to show some of the work that I do with him and his team. What I'm going to start off by doing is really just talking to you a little bit about my journey into digital. Why, when I was sat there, I think it must have been about 4 years ago, thinking, should I do this? Should I not? Should I do this? Should I not? What's the right time to invest? Should I, you know, when I was sat on the fence about digital. So at that time, I realized that I was asking my lab for a lot of STL files. And what you can see here is a model and this model has been scanned. And then this, once it's been scanned and digitized, I've then done some implant planning with this model. And I find I was asking for this more and more and more. And I thought I'd reached the point where maybe actually I should be able to make these myself, rather than every time having to go through the process of taking an impression, sending off to the laboratory. They would send it back to me as a wax up. I'd then approve it all and then send it back to the laboratory again, and they would digitize it. And this would take a number of, this would take a number of weeks to go through that process. So I thought maybe it's time to look at what's out there. The other thing that really, really pushed me into this was I started to become much more interested in how the abutments that I was ordering from my lab were designed. I started to realize that there's much more that could be done, that within that there was, I could ask for more, I could design these things, because previously all that would happen is you'd ask for an abutment and it would come back in whatever shape or form. Whereas I realized that I could now have a hand in this by deciding and telling my laboratory how to design my abutments. So those two things were really the two things that kickstarted my journey into digital. And really, today's not really a clinical talk. It's more of a practice-based talk and a talk around the things we've been doing digital rather than showing you case after case. So really what I want to start off with, once I've told you why I went digital, is I want to talk to you again about who will benefit from digital within your practice and within your team, and what we've found in our practice that has been useful to the people that we work with. The other thing that I want to talk about is the sort of thing that you can typically do with digital, and just show you a couple of simple cases in the time we've got, just to illustrate some of the things that are possible with this technology, so that hopefully you take the time to start doing some digital work yourself and take the leap in some ways. I'm just going to start off with showing you some of the different aspects of the data that we collect digitally. So we collect digital photos, which you're all used to. There's no analog cameras anymore, or at least you have to go out and look for one rather than get one off the shelf. Digital x-rays and CT scans are now normal. So really, if you've got a lot of this stuff like digital x-rays, if you've got a scanner for implantology, which is fairly, which is normal, or access to a scanner, a digital impression will be a massive game changer to what you can do within your practice. It will be a game changer because not only will you be able to do more, but you will find that you use it much more than you think you do. So from looking at when I thought, I just want some STL files for some guides, what I use it for now is far, far, far more than that. And I think it's been a hugely worthwhile investment for us at the practice. And you'll hear me highlight how other people within the practice are using this technology. So when you're still on the side and when you meet someone like me, I give you all these reasons to go digital. I tell you it's going to be as accurate, or in some cases potentially more accurate than using analog impressions, depending on the scenario. I'm going to say it's going to save you chair time. Your patients are not going to gag. Your patients will find it more comfortable. I'm going to tell you there's going to be a wow factor within your practice as they see everything on the screen and as they see their teeth and how this reflects on your, on the investment that they see that you've made in yourself as a person and your practice. And I think the other thing we're going to talk about really is the storage, the reproducibility, and also about the monitoring tooth wear and movement. I only think it's fair that you look at the other side of this, because when you're sat there on the other side, you're thinking, hang on, I'm not sure how much this is going to cost. This is going to be a huge investment for me as a business, so I'm not sure this is worth it at this time. You're seeing a whole heap of different systems on the market at the moment. You're not sure which one to invest in because one is better at this, the other is better at that. There's a lot of data that flies around and you're not sure which one to go to. So again, you might be stood on the side waiting, thinking, is this the time or do I wait for the next scanner to come along? The other part is the learning curve. You're worried that when you start this, you're going to have to learn a lot. You're going to have to invest a lot of time to get to the point where you're, and if you're not particularly geeky or technical, you're worried that this is going to take up a lot of your time. And we'll address that and talk to you about, again, we'll just show you something a little bit simple. We'll also show you something a little bit more complex, but not just to show that the range of what you can do with digital. I think the other thing that I was worried about is that, everyone's got this bottom drawer in their practice of stuff that they bought once, they brought back from a show, and they never really used. And you're worried that you're going to buy this thing, you're not really going to use it, you're going to spend a lot of money on it, and you're not going to get value or return on the investment within your practice. And a part of that is related to the last point, where you don't think it's got many uses in your practice. And hopefully over the course of, this 10, 15 minutes, you'll see the different uses in your practice and how you can actually put digital to work to actually do really well for your practice financially, and also do really well for the perception of your practice, and also how you can actually really, really engage your team in this journey and this process. So when we talk about who's going to benefit from digital, I think it's important that we talk about, there's five different groups that I think of. I think of you or me as the dentist, and how you can communicate better with patients, with staff members, how you can communicate better with the labs, and how that's going to be a massive benefit to you and your practice. I also think about patients and how patients are going to benefit. They're going to benefit from you being able to communicate better with them. They're going to benefit from the increased comfort that you get from digital impressions. They're going to benefit from being more engaged with the treatment because they understand what you're doing and actually the steps and stages involved. We're also going to talk about how your dental technician and you can communicate better, can do more together. How, you know, Steve and I send each other little files all the time, HTML files, where there's changes and edits and things. And we're going to show you a typical case that goes between us on a typical day, and actually the level of communication, the speed with which we can get that communication, which actually speeds up the process from when I showed you at the beginning with the wax up, which went, again, that would have been 2 weeks back to me, back to the laboratory, another week back to me, another week to get digitized. That whole process would have taken 4 weeks, and we can really, really condense that much more now with the tools that we have. We're also going to talk again, I'm going to talk a little bit about this, not a huge amount, but I work alongside a team of people, endodontists, periodontists, orthodontists, restorative dentists, and sometimes my part is a very small part of the whole picture. Sometimes my part is a very big part of the whole picture, and being able to communicate effectively with a team of specialists, sometimes internally, and occasionally they may be external to the practice, is again a huge boost, and digital allows us to do that much, much better than we can with analog and letters and kind of drawing on photos. There's a lot more we can do within our communication. And finally, not to be forgotten, is the person paying the bill. The person paying your patient's bill, the decision maker, allowing them into the communication process, I think, is key, because you're going to find that by having them as part of the process, by having them see the screen with the digital models in place, showing them the gap, in my case, or the collapsed bite, or the missing tooth, or the uneven spaces, or the teeth that need to be straightened. Having that information to hand is a huge help to all the people who might be involved in making this decision. So again, just bear in mind, it's not just you. It's not just you and your practice, but actually using this technology in the right way enables you to reach many more people than you would by just taking a photo or writing a treatment plan or giving a piece of paper with some numbers on it at the bottom of it. So let's talk about it from, I think, probably the point of view of your patients. And what is it? What is the patient experience like when they have a scan? What do your patients think when they come in? Because I went through I did the honor of asking one of the clinical dental technician who works with us, Jamie Bray, and I asked him for some photos of some impressions. And he assures me none of these are mine, by the way. But he sent me some photos of impressions. And when you look at this, you ask yourself, was that a comfortable experience for the patient? Would they come back again if you said actually there was an air blow in a particular area? Or, you know, would they prefer to have something different? And I know you think, okay, this might be a slightly extreme example, but actually, you know, this is not so unusual as you might expect. So is that a nice patient experience? So I would say no. And from the perspective of the patient, there's probably another way in which they would like to have, get the same result, but without having impression material down to their tonsils and down to their vocal cords in this case. Let's also think about another aspect of the patient experience. Let's think about this lady who came in. Let's think about taking the impression on her. If you look at how mobile those teeth are, is alginate going to pull them out? Is putty going to pull them out? And the fact we're able to say to her, look, I'm really happy to tell you, I'm not going to need to take an impression, a normal impression on these, but I will be able to proceed and start your treatment and do the planning. And she had stayed away wondering how, you know, she was going to wander around with no teeth, but we're able to reassure her that she's going to keep her teeth as they are until we can obviously get to replace them, because we're able to use digital technology with her. And again, another slightly unusual case that walked in this week. And again, when we look at this, you think, okay, you know, you might get the impression material caught underneath the bridge. But if we look at the upper jaw of this particular patient, you know, she's had a cleft palate repaired, and what you can see there is the repair over the palate. They've used a piece of her tongue to repair the palate. And you think that's not going to be a particularly comfortable experience for her, having a normal impression. Waving a wand in her mouth, on the other hand, and, you know, taking a digital impression is going to be by far a much better, you know, by far an improved patient experience for her. And it means that when you look at these two videos that you should see playing here, if you look at the steps and stages that we go through with the one on the left-hand side when we're doing a full arch implant impression, whereas the one on the right-hand side, again, we're doing a full arch implant impression. In this case, you can see me doing it with the prime scan. If you think about all the steps and stages you have to go through and think about what this feels like from the patient perspective, whether you screw on, you know, six or eight different independent scan bodies, and then just scan and wave a wand around the mouth, versus the experience you see on the left-hand side, which I think for the patient is much more involved. And you can see me here joining the verification jig to make sure everything is passive. What you can see here is a really traditional way of taking a full arch impression. And having light cured it, you'll see me go through all the steps and stages. The patient's got to stay open throughout all of this. And if they close at all, they're going to bite on one of those long impression posts that stick up. And again, when you see the amount of material we have to use, and again, if you just focus on the left-hand one of these videos again, you'll see me putting the material underneath there, having to carefully get it all the way underneath the verification jig to pick everything up. You start to wonder, which would your patient prefer? And you think, well, if there's a different way to do it, if you're a patient, would you pick the experience on the right or the experience on the left? And if we just carry on with this video for another 2 or 3 minutes, so you can see the end of it as it comes up, you'll see me insert the impression. And it's the, you know, when we insert the impression, it's what I call, you know, there's the moment of reckoning coming just here, where you have to put this impression tray in, and you have about 20 or 30 seconds to find each of the heads of each of those little implant, or each of those little, of the impression posts. And you're working furiously away. You're not really thinking about the back of the mouth at this point, because unless you get that out, unless you get those impression posts clear, you might have to, you know, do something more, or drill or cut in order to get to the point of the top of the impression tray. So when you think about that from a patient perspective, what would your patient want? And if we just again go to the next slide, you'd ask yourself, okay, what does the evidence say in terms of patient perception of digital? And I just went along to PubMed sometime last week and had a look. And this is a recent meta-analysis done by some chaps in Australia that look at patient preference for this. And having shown you that small selection of impressions, it would be no surprise to you that the patients preferred digital impressions to analog impressions. So with that in mind, we've got to bear in mind that actually from a patient's perspective, we know that digital impressions are preferable to analog impressions. How about for my lab? What do they prefer? And what I did was I got, again, a full arch impression. You can see here, this isn't perfect. You can see that there's some air blows just around one of the scan bodies on the upper left-hand side of the screen. There's some areas where the impression material has got underneath the impression post. So this might actually be a retake. But if we look at all the steps and stages involved in making an impression, and you look at something like this, you look at poorly mixed material, that's no way you're going to give a decent impression for the laboratory. And that's another one again, that's again not going to give a particularly good impression for the laboratory. And if you also think about the fact that actually this material is poorly set, you can see there's a finger mark in there, because as the materials arrived at the laboratory, it's still soft. So the laboratory technician has been able to put his finger in that. And if we have a look at this, where we see the actual denture has moved during the impression, which means you might end up with something like this on the left-hand side. So if we then go a little bit further and we talk about actually here, yes, okay, we've got lots of things right, but the tray has come away, the impressions come away from the tray, which means actually that's not going to be accurate. And finally, if you think, okay, this is just for our analog impressions, if we look at this digital impression here, you can see that really, I'm not quite sure how and where that came about, but you can see actually that's going to leave a real problem for your laboratory. Sending that to your laboratory is leaving them in a position where actually they have to go through all the trouble of asking you to do it again, or attempting to work with whatever you've sent them. And if we, again, look at the next stage, this is a case where we've taken some, my colleague has taken some traditional impressions, he's had an alginate, he's had them cast, and he's had a wax up done. Now, because of how I've wanted to work, what I've done is I've got that wax up and I've scanned it. And what you can see when you look closely is you can see all the air blows along the gingival margin that exist. And what I've done is taken that, I've scanned it, and then I've sent it over to the team at Nexus Dental Laboratory. And what they've done is they've then combined the scan with an intraoral scan that I've taken, because I've taken an intraoral scan of the same patient. And it's taken me no longer to do the intraoral scan. But if we just focus again on those areas of the gingival margin, and when you look at how we fade into and out of the analog impression that's been cast versus the digital impression that's coming up in a second, you'll see there's, again, just looking just at the gingival margins, you see there's detail there that in the digital impression that's not in the analog impression. And also the fact that if I do miss an area when I'm doing the scan, if I've got an air blow where I'm doing the scan, I can just literally scan that area again. It doesn't involve putting the alginate into the patient's mouth again. The retake is very, very straightforward. It's not restarting the process, it's filling in the area that we need to. And again, if we look at the two, I've just gone through this with you, you can see the upper and the lower there, and you can see the difference, and you can see the air blows in place. So which would my lab rather work with? And I remembered an incident recently, and I went back and I had a look at, there was a day that I'd taken the impressions and I'd set them to one side. I'd told my nurse, okay, look, I haven't quite written the doctorate, can we leave it there? And I disappeared off and I'd come back and her efficiency, you know, she'd cleared everything up and she'd sent everything to the lab. And I got this lovely note from this particular laboratory. And if you read it, it says that I've only put the patient, there's only a patient's name, there's no date, there's no instructions, there's nothing really for them to work with on this. So you can talk about how that level of communication from an analog perspective and what you see with Steve, I hope is a little bit better than that, Steve. I hope I've improved a little bit from that. But you can see how just again, within communicating amongst a team, you can do it much better using this sort of technology rather than a notepad, you know, using digital technology rather than pen and paper. If we talk about the other part, which is around 2 years ago, we moved out of our practice and we moved to a new facility just up the road. And we had the inevitable experience of going through the basement which no one had cleared out for many, many years. So Nick and I went down there and the number of plaster models we found in the basement, we found there was about 10, 12 years of these models in there. We have to then store them. We've got to take them to a storage facility. We've got all this stuff hanging around. And we're in London where space is expensive. So we're paying money to store this stuff. Whereas what you need to ask yourself is how much would this cost if this was digitized? For those of you who don't know, on the right-hand side, that's what 25 years ago, that's what 100 megabytes looks like. And that's called a zip drive. Things have moved on a little bit from there. And what you can see here is one of the models that we pulled out on that day. And I've pulled this up because even if you store your models correctly, what we found when we looked is you can see there's a little bit of mold, a little bit of dirt on them. You know, you wouldn't necessarily be very keen to make an appliance directly on these models and then put that into the patient's mouth. You would want to go through some sort of cleansing process. So again, there's problems in terms of the volume you store and the method with which you store it, because the plaster models can degrade over time, whereas the digital information, the ones and zeros, will remain stable, we hope indefinitely, or we know indefinitely. The final bit I'm going to talk about, the next bit I'm going to talk about, is how our team get on with this. And I'm just going to play a little video.
When I have a patient in the chair and we're ready to proceed with a scan, it's very handy that I can empower my nurse and basically delegate that responsibility to her. The main advantage of that is that I can then focus on my other duties, which my nurse can't carry out for me. So I can be updating my notes, getting all my photographs uploaded onto the system. I can then be there with the patients, and that just completes that kind of in-practice workflow.
By us undertaking the scans here at 10 Dental, it allows the clinicians to get on more with the technical planning. It also allows us to understand the procedure a lot more effectively and the patient to understand what the outcome is going to be.
It's been really good for the team engagement. You know, by having three or four nurses in the practice who can scan, and this means that actually as a team we can work more effectively together. So this saves me time, it engages the team more, and also engages the patients more.
So as a team, it's really, really useful having our nurses being able to scan. By engaging them within the process of the consultation, by them saving me time, you know, being able to do the first scan on the patient, it really has been a game changer for us. And it's something that we encourage all of our team to do. And they've really, really enjoyed being engaged in that process. So we've talked a little bit about different things, and what I'm going to just finish off with is just a couple of examples of the sort of thing you can do right now with digital. And I'm just going to talk about, you know, this is one of the things I thought about, what can we do better with digital? And I'm going to pick a case like this, who comes in, and she's in this week to have the surgery completed, but this is one that Steve and I are working on. He'll show you his part near the end. This lady's come in to have the upper left one replaced. Now, I can communicate with Steve by saying, look, Steve, can you see this tooth on the right? I want you to copy this tooth onto the left. And what he's been able to do then is copy that. You can, and once he's copied that, this is not the copy, this is the original that I've worked on. I've been able to get a CT scan of that, combine the CT scan with the STL data. This is the copy that I've got from him. It comes in two pieces, one where he's cut out the tooth, the second where he's put the temporary tooth, which is an exact replica of the tooth on the other side. And I've been able to plan where the implant's going to go, what size implant. I've been able to pick what abutment I'm going to put in. And with that, I've been able to say to Steve, pretty much within the course of this must have taken him, you know, not very long to do and communicate back to me. We've been able to move forward with all the steps and stages so that what we're able to do is to get all that information, pass it between us very rapidly so that I'm able to do the bit that I need to do, which is to plan the implants, order a guide if I want to in this case, look at what the temporary tooth is going to look like, which makes the delivery for the patient, again, much, much easier and much, much quicker, a little bit more straightforward. And the other thing I've been able to do with this is to say to Steve, look, in order to make it easier for me, can you please make me a temporary, that I can locate fairly easily in the mouth, and I can, you know, just use this to make the temporary crown very quickly and very easily for the patient. So we've been able to go through these steps and stages really, really easily. You know, this can come back in a short period of time, and we've got something that we can work with really, really quickly, really, really easily to benefit the patient and also to speed up my chair time while I'm in the practice. And if we talk a little bit more about, again, this is at the other end. This is a case we completed a little while ago where the ladies come in to have an upper arch replaced. And as part of this, we're placing five implants. We've been able to communicate with a laboratory or some designers abroad in order for them to design this wax up for me and me to have some involvement in the design of the wax up. And based on the design of the wax up, we've been able to, you know, plan the surgery. If I wanted a guide, we could use it or not, you know, that, you know, we couldn't. And then from there, having known where the implants are going to go, the size of the abutments, knowing, again, the shape of the teeth that we're going to make, we've gone through and carried out the surgery. Now, what we want to do is, she's really liked this wax up that you can see in the first picture. What we want to do is we want to copy that to the final. And by carrying out this process, which Steve and I will talk about a little bit later in a little bit more detail, which is being able to scan directly in the mouth using the prime scan. And then with this scan, and this is in real time that you can see on the left-hand side, I haven't on the screen, I haven't sped this up at all. This is not her scan, by the way, it's another one from about a week ago. We've been able to scan the patient, and by a process which involves Steve and the team at Atlantis, we've been able to go from this scan through a form of verification to being able to make her final restoration without having to take a conventional impression in this case. And the advantage for us is being able to go through this process where we're able to scan the patient, again, scan the provisional, copy the provisional. We're able to produce, again, this is a lovely bridge produced by Steve and his team. And what you can see here is the final result. And this is the x-ray showing the fit, which, you know, is a really, really great fit. Some great work done by the team at Bentheim. We're able to, again, have that predictability so that when the patient likes the look of something, they agree to the look of it, we're able to deliver that using the digital tools and technology that we've got. So really, that's a little bit of a whirlwind tour about what we do in the practice, how this engages the team. I'm now going to hand back to Jack, who's going to take over from here and give you another perspective on this. So thank you very much, and please do put any questions in the chat.
Thank you very much, Martin. I'm just going to take back control of the presentation, so let me know if you can see that okay. Looking good. There we go. Thank you again. Always great to see one of your presentations. It was particularly good looking at the prime scan, just scanning that implant case there. So it's a bit of a sneak peek of what's coming up very shortly. I'm about to do a scan. Just once we cover some of the things that you should be looking for when you make your decision on a scanner. So to begin with, when you begin to look at a scanner, obviously the scanner market, there are a lot of scanners to choose from. And something to consider, something to keep in mind as you're looking at these scanners, I would say one of the top things is probably the speed of the scanner. So I would say to check how quick the scanning is, check that the scanner can keep up with you. Because obviously scanning isn't an exact science. We're humans, we can't move our hands and maintain a precise speed and a precise angle like a lab scanner can. And therefore, an intraoral scanner needs to be able to pick up information as quickly as our hands are moving. What we want to avoid really is a situation where we're taking a scan, we scan a quadrant or a full arch, and when we look back at the screen, we realize that 50% of the information that we tried to pick up just simply isn't on screen, meaning that we've got to take a necessary passes again back with the camera. So what I would say is when you're testing a scanner, test the scanner obviously on a model to get the hang of it. If you can, try and use the scanner maybe on one of your nurses or even on yourself, if that's possible. And after a little bit of practice, if the scanning takes longer than about 2 or 3 minutes, especially on the model, I would say probably in 2020, that's probably not an optimal scanning experience in terms of speed. So, you know, factoring everything into account, time is always money. Scanning quickly enables us to save money and also improves the patient experience. Because we want to ideally spend as little time as possible taking that impression for the sake of both you and your patient. Let's not forget, speed is fantastic, but what would be the point in being able to scan fast if the impression is actually less accurate than a traditional impression to begin with? So take into account, you know, going digital is, you know, we're supposed to modernize without any compromises whatsoever. And every aspect of this should be an improvement compared to what we used to with analog impressions. So the accuracy of a scanner is the combination of trueness and precision. And this will ensure simply that your crowns, bridges, aligners, all sorts of appliances will be fabricated accurately by your technician without any of the guesswork that you have with traditional impression material. Higher accuracy simply means that your restorations will fit better and more consistently. So ensure that the accuracy of the scanner is up to par and is at least more accurate than a traditional impression, because that's not the case for every scanner. And with that, the ease of use of the scanner should be a really big consideration for you. So if we look back to 20 years ago or even 10 years ago, scanners were nice things to have, but they weren't so easy to use, at least not to learn. All scanners at one point required powder to be sprayed onto the teeth in order to actually obtain any sort of scan. And really only one image could be taken at a time, meaning scanning was quite a slow process and quite a technique sensitive process. And these were often taken with a foot pedal. Really, a scanner in 2020 should be able to scan any surface, regardless of how reflective it is, without powder and in full colour. Something you've got to take into account is also the size of the scanner. So remember that pretty much all scanners you're going to look at are going to be larger than the relatively fine tools that you're used to working with as a dentist. So using these inside a patient's mouth, we want to keep the size hopefully to a minimum, or at least have some sort of system in place in order to deal with issues such as soft tissue. So taking something as big as a camera into a mouth, soft tissue will be an issue. Patients, dentists that have intraoral scanners will often tell you that patients like to lick the lens of the camera, just instinctively, and also their cheeks will get in the way, lips. So something you should consider with a scanner really is, as part of the system, it should be intelligent enough to cut soft tissue automatically out of the scan. And this will just make your life a million times easier rather than accidentally scanning soft tissue and having to delete the scan and start again, or having to trim bits out of it. On a side note, away from the actual part we physically hold in our hands, you should also factor in the actual body of the scanner, because scanners do come in different formats. You most often see them as cart-based systems. Some of them you see with that come with a laptop instead of the cart. And when we're talking about ease of use in terms of the overall system, what we should consider really is, with laptops, these aren't registered medical devices, and therefore they shouldn't really be brought within about a meter and a half of a patient, which does provide an issue in terms of making sure you're able to see the screen okay, and then also in terms of keeping that laptop clean. Most cart-based systems you see are intended as registered medical devices, meaning that they're easy to clean, and you can roll them to you when needed and then roll them out of the way when they're not needed. They look better. Usually they provide a better patient communication tool because they come with nice big screens. So this is also something that you should consider, not just the actual camera itself, but the system that it's a part of. And if we think so far, all we've talked about is the actual scanning experience. But importantly, these scans don't stay on our system. The intention is to send these out to somebody like Steve, so to your lab technician. And part of your decision really should be ensuring that these scans are able to be sent openly to any service, any lab technician, any provider out there. Also, making sure you have some sort of dedicated scanning software which has a lab function built in terms of being able to send directly through to your lab through the scanning software without needing separate applications or separate different services in order to do that. Really, to make everybody's life easier, it should be going through the same piece of software. That's going to be as efficient as a workflow as we can get. And these bits of software, they should allow you to message the technician directly through there. The technician should be able to message you back on a per case basis. If we'd have a system that doesn't provide this, the issue we then have is, well, one, how do we send these scans to a lab technician? And what people will recommend is using some sort of file sharing service. But of course, these aren't necessarily secure or safe to use. But also, you still have the same issue we have with traditional impressions, is the communication with your lab. If you've got multiple cases on the go, multiple ways of communication via email, WhatsApp, phone, it can get very difficult. I'm sure you're all experiencing in terms of keeping in communication about all of those different cases. Really, everything should ideally be segmented on a per scan basis. And just on an extra note with connectivity, when you make an investment like this, you want to make sure, because it is it's going to be an expensive investment, you want to make sure that it's future proof. Don't be limited by your decision now of something that you possibly want to do in the future. So, for example, check that the scanner, if potentially milling things in house is a consideration for you, ensure that the functionality is there before you make that decision when you purchase. When it comes to training, obviously most manufacturers try to make their devices as easy as possible to use, but especially with dentistry, training always needs to be provided, and ideally this needs to be clinician led. So check what the support is like with the manufacturer and the supplier that you're looking to purchase the equipment from. Also check that the updates come free of charge, check there's no license fees, and check if there's any sort of system for self-help if you can't get hold of anybody, or online videos, that kind of thing. And now, as working for a manufacturer, we would like to think that we never have any issues with our devices, and I think every manufacturer would be the same. But obviously we know that's not reality. Devices often have issues. It's just something that nobody can avoid. What we want to make sure is that if and when they do appear, you have the security there. You have that quick support in terms of having an alternative or having something fixed. So make sure this manufacturer that you're looking to purchase the scanner from has a few years at least experience in dental scanning, is established in the market and well recognized, and is a reputable company. I would say also make sure you're actually able to reach some sort of tech support hotline or a local rep quickly if you have any questions or anything you need support with. And with that, I will shortly be moving over to my Prime Scan. And just a quick note in terms of Dents Barcelona, we're obviously a huge player when it comes to intraoral scanning. And recently we actually set a new milestone in scanning. And obviously you've heard from Martin already about some of the things that the Prime Scan can do. And obviously we're over the moon that it was his choice of scanner. So if you please bear with me for a few minutes, I'm just going to move over to the Prime Scan beside me, where I will do a full demo using a model, and we'll send over to our lab technician, Steve, where he'll then continue. So if you bear with me about 30 seconds, I'll just switch over to that now. Right, so hopefully everybody can see that. Steve and Martin, are we looking good? Fantastic, thank you guys. So tonight I am actually going to be scanning a model. And with that, you know, the models that we use, they're opaque, you know, they're models, they do the job. But first of all, I just wanted to show everybody what they can expect from the Prime Scan in terms of scan quality. And obviously you've seen Martin do this already. But just to very quickly show you in terms of what a scan of a patient would look like, I actually have a Prime Scan in front of me. It's got a massive touchscreen, and I'm just using my fingers, just like an iPhone or Android device, just to pinch and zoom and just to scroll around. And I can view this impression from any angle in this level of detail. And I can switch to the upper jaw there. Just to give everybody an idea of a realistic idea of what they can expect from the Prime Scan. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to load a new case. And what we have in front of us is the Dents Barcelona Connect software. And what this software allows you to do is, first of all, take a scan. It then allows us to connect to any lab that is registered on our system. They then receive it instantly, and then they can communicate to you via the chat function here about specific cases. And when it comes to us starting an impression, we actually have several different options, which would save us time from having to type this manually later in the scan. So the model I've got in front of me is I don't know how clearly everybody can see that on screen there, but I've got a single unit crown and prep on this model. So with my finger, I touch the tooth
that I'm looking to restore, and I've selected that it's a crown. Obviously, we could scan for aligners, we could scan for bridges or implants, have all of those options. What we can then do is we can select a material. So I could tell Steve that I want this making from zirconia. And that instantly, in the space of a couple of seconds, without me having to type anything, is now automatically included within the case. And when I'm happy to proceed, I click next, and this brings me to the scanning screen. When I pick the Prime Scan camera up, it automatically starts scanning, ready for me to take this into the patient's mouth. And all we do is we literally take the camera on top of the teeth like this, and we take a scan as simply as that. And in the space of maybe about 2 seconds, we've got all of the occlusal information there. If I continue where I left off, I can take this around and get the lingual surfaces and roll over just to fill in that buccal information. And now obviously things are sped up here because this is a model scan. Obviously it's not going to be this quick in a patient's mouth, just because obviously I've got no soft tissue, I've got no lips to contend with. But the Prime Scan will keep up as fast as you're seeing me move this. And hopefully you could get an idea of that from Martin's videos. So I'm just observing around this prep site, and I can see that I've got all the information that I would need. Any missing bits of information, I can take the camera back over and it will pick up instantly. I'm then going to scan the upper jaw. And just to demonstrate a point, when I was talking about the intelligent removal of soft tissue, if I start this scan with my thumb in place, so if we imagine this was the patient's tongue, you can see my thumb on screen there. The software is intelligent enough to know that teeth don't move, but soft tissue does. So if something moves in the scan, it doesn't belong there. So as long as I move that soft tissue out of the way and scan this area again, the software will automatically pull it out of the scan. If I then reintroduce my thumb, so if we reintroduce the tongue, it will then block this out of the scanner and it will refuse to put it in because it knows it shouldn't be there. So that was just demonstrating how that would intelligently deal with soft tissue. So I'm just going to finish this scan. Now this scanner, you can also use to take a shade reading, so we can keep this color calibrated. And we can use it as that. We can also use this to take intraoral pictures and also videos. And these will also be included within the case that we send to the lab technician. We can choose which ones we want to send. We then get the patient to bite and we take a buccal bite scan as quickly as that. I could also go to the other side and I can take a bilateral buccal bite scan. And what we can see the software has done is it's automatically aligned that jaw that we've already scanned based on those buccal bite registrations there. I then move forwards, and what's happening here is, you know, during that scan, I've taken thousands and thousands of images, and the software is now processing through all of that raw information, getting rid of everything it doesn't need, and it's processing full resolution, high quality textures, all of the shade information, and the result is you would get a scan similar to what you saw at the start of this. Obviously I'm scanning a completely opaque model here, so there's not going to be a lot of depth to it. And one of the benefits with digital impression scanner, you know, obviously you've heard this all night, but if we get to this next model stage when we're looking at our final impression and there is any missing information there, that would be important. Unlike a traditional impression, we don't have to retake the whole thing, wait 4 or 5 minutes for it to set. It really is as simple as going back into the acquisition stage and just starting that scanner back up just to fill in that missing bit of information, which takes a few seconds. And I can just look at this scan here. See, I've got all of that information there. I'm happy with that. Epidural scan looks fantastic as well. I can then click connect. just log into my account, and my account remembers all of the labs that I have saved. And then we can add any labs at any time. We then get a notification down here, a little progress bar to tell us it's going to take about 30 seconds for this to upload to the cloud. While that's happening, I can maximize my time by entering the order details already. So I can click normalize off. This is a male patient. We're going to send this to Nexus Dental Lab, which is where Steve works. I'm going to be very kind to him. I'm going to give him 2 weeks to work on this case because I know he likes 2 weeks. Like 2 weeks is just a plus for him. We can enter any extra details here. So the prime scan, the screen can actually be kind of rotated all the way down, so it's almost flat. And I can type on it nicely like that. Because I've got a webcam on, I'm going to do it kind of upright. So I could say, if I hadn't done this already, please make in Zerk. All my notes get contained there within the case, don't have to do anything physically. This is already done. I can then add it to my cart. And this is essentially like putting it into my digital basket. And once I'm happy with that, I can just click Submit Cart. And because it's already in the cloud, as soon as I give that authorization, it's instantly with Steve. Okay, so again, if you bear with me a few seconds, I'm just going to move back to my laptop and just to cover a few things before we hand over to Steve. So just bear with me.
Back, so I'm just going to share. Ooh. Take this volume down. Hear me twice. So, in terms of what you just saw me demonstrating from, this is what the actual machine looks like, and you saw it in Martin's video earlier. The screen which I had in front of me is a full-size widescreen touchscreen, so it's very easy to use. It's nice to let the patients use it. Often when you're taking scans for digital aligners and you're performing ortho simulations and that kind of thing, it's really, really nice to see the patients interacting with it, and they just engage with it really well. It really gets your point across much better than just explaining things with words. You've also got a touchpad below that. There's very, very few seams on the prime scan, so it's very easy to wipe down. The carts, obviously we were talking about carts and laptops earlier. This is a cart-based system, and it works via battery. So you've got about 4 hours on standby with a battery, or about 60 minutes of constant scanning time. So it's enough to last you about half a day at least of scanning. And what we also have is quite a comprehensive hygiene concept with the PrimeScan camera itself. The tips that you saw Martin scanning with in his videos were the disposable heads. What I was scanning there with was the wipeable head, but we also do have an autoclavable head with that as well. So everything's been very, very well thought out with the Prime Scan. And with every purchase of the Prime Scan, you get a free lab license, which enables you to give this to your lab if they don't already have the inbox needed to receive the scans. You can give this to them and we can get them set up with that. Now, when I hand over to Steve in a second, Steve will show you what this software looks like from his side and what he then does with it. So take it away, Steve.
Thank you very much, Jack. Thank you, everybody, for joining us this evening. Just a quick flip back to the poll. At the beginning, we've seen that the main aim really is for people to learn more about digital dentistry. We've seen you've got quite a lot of a spread there of things that you're looking at utilizing the intraoral scanner for. Myself and Martin have got some very exciting things that we're going to share right at the very end during the Q&A. And also, please do feel free to keep firing the questions in to the chat, and we will pick on at the end and we'll come back to you and answer them. Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to show you what happens when we accept that order. So let's pop up.
Do you want to request control, Steve?
I'm just going to show this bit first, if you don't mind, and then we'll come back. Okay, so you've seen that come across to me from Jack. Now, what I love about this is we have instant communication. If there's anything here when we're previewing it, I can type any notes in here. Everything comes back to Jack instantly. One of the bigger holdups in laboratories, between laboratories and surgery, is actually a very simple thing. It's just not very good communication. And then there's also that thing of, you'll get sometimes the front desk ringing. Did you get those impressions? We sent you some impressions. Did you get them? You spend quite a lot of your time answering an admin team, assuring them you have got their work. Here, everybody's notified at every stage. You know where your case is. You know how it's proceeding. And as Jack mentioned, all the information is kept together. And I think that's incredible. From a lab perspective, and this is very important for any lab you choose to work with, it allows completely open workflows. So we do have InLab here. We also have 3Shape. We also have Exocad. We also have Dental Wings. I can literally take those files in any format we wish. And that means we can have the full color scans. We can just keep it as simple STLs. And that means that not only ourselves, but as Martin touched on earlier, we work as part of a global team. He'll actually do some of his diagnostic work with SmartCloud, who are in Europe. Whereas we are just going to pop in and out at different stages. And it's very important to have that usability and freedom to be able to choose your file type. Not all scanners have this, and it can actually make it very difficult to deliver what somebody wants without having to print models, rescan, go through different workflows. So this really is about keeping the efficiency and communication clean. So when we accept the case, one of the other really nice features about this is it plays very well with other bits of software. So I'm just going to show you now on the degree of freedom. I'm just going to share one more screen. Let's have that. So new share, and we're going to share with you. Here we go. Okay, so the case has come in. Now I'm using Exocad here. It could be any number of other softwares, but what I like about it is there is no double data entry. I literally can accept the case here now. It goes straight into that database. So you can actually set up scripts to put it straight into the software of your choice. So I'll be able to take that in, accept it, and I'll actually be starting to work on a case from Jack or Nick or Martin genuinely within minutes. So you can see, again, all the information's come in. I'm just going to just change that name. I'm going to work on this personally because Jack's very kind. He's given me 2 weeks. That makes him one of my favorites. So I'm going to work on his case. So what we would do at this point is literally just start launching in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you back to the presentation. I'm going to walk you through just how quick and effective that is. So I'm just going to stop the share. If you wouldn't mind resharing, Jack, and then I will request control and I'll continue the presentation. Fantastic. Thank you very much. Right. So, and I think that the theme I'm really going to try and get across to you here, this really is what it's about. It is improving the communication between you and your lab partner or any of the services you want to utilize, be it aligners, be it anything else, they're going to be there. And because everything's so well interconnected, it's a cloud-based system, it means I get notified on a few different streams. You know I'm not going to miss your case. You know I'm going to see it. I'm going to get onto it very quickly. It's a nice workflow for a lab. Labs enjoy working this way. I'm not waiting, disinfecting impressions, casting impressions, waiting for them to set, taking them off, trimming them before I can get on with the real work. I really want to get straight into that. So we get an email, which means that even if I'm not in the laboratory, I can still see important information. I can coordinate with my team and make sure that that case is ongoing straight away. And as Jack mentioned, one of the nice things about it is you can see down at the bottom here, although I've just blanked them out, you can actually attach photographs. You can put more files with that scan that you sent across, which means that I can instantly pull them in and I can be looking at the photographs, any more information that you've sent. As Martin sent the one showing me the way he wanted that tooth copying. And I've said it's an open system. So this is where we left you. I accept the case. I'm ready to go. And then we're going to start work. But this is a digital talk, so I'm not going to start working like this, because this is how things used to be. But I still think it's an incredible skill. You still need to know what you're doing. You still need to be a good skilled technician to get the most out of these. So now when we do diagnostic wax-ups, we don't do them with the wax knife. This is my new tool. This is what we now work with. The labs we work in now, they look more like design studios. We don't have very dirty, messy areas. It's a nicer place to work. So you can see this scan that I've gotten from Martin. It's the case he showed you earlier. And he's basically said to me, okay, that tooth is going to be an immediate implant placement. So what I want you to do, Steve, is I want you to copy that other tooth. Martin's, both Martin, Nick, and a lot of the people we work with, I've got to say, one of the good things about this, it's really helped me understand really what he wants, because he's really pushed us further and further. You know, wax-ups, or when people think of a digital diagnostic wax-up, they think, oh, it's just like a stock denture tooth. It's just going to be popped in. Well, it isn't anymore. We understand that they really want that biogeneric reference. They want them to be unique. This is that patient's tooth. The way I'm going to do it, you can see that I've overlaid the 3D onto his 2D image. And that means that when I've got the starting position, I can socket away the tissue. And already you can see, because Martin's told me he wants to make that tooth the same, I've also moved the tissue up. So I've actually made sure the tissue position is going to be in the right place for Martin to develop his implant crown. You can see the overlay here where we started. You can see the 2D just coming through. And I literally did a clone of that patient's central. So I did a clone, we flipped it over, we popped it in. But at this stage, and this for me is the most important bit, Martin touched on this at the beginning. Traditionally, I used to have to wax something up, we'd pop it in a box, we'd send it back. The surgeon would look at it and say, this is not what I wanted at all. Or, okay, that's fine, but that's coming back. Now we're going to move on. This wax up, I will have literally gone through these stages and Martin will have this back in about half an hour. That means that we really are improving the way we communicate. Before any of us have committed to the cost of producing anything, Martin's looking at exactly the same thing I'm looking at. He can manipulate it and turn it in 3D. He can look at it with his own plan in mind and make sure what I'm trying to offer him is suitable for where he wants to take the case. This is actually another simple diagnostic case that we did with Nick Sasodia, just on that lateral there. Again, that was another flip copy. When we get approval, we produce a model. So it's kind of back to front. Digitally, you do all your work first, the model comes last. In analog, the model comes first and everything must be done to the model. That's not the case digitally. And you can see all of the surface texture, all the detailing, everything of that tooth is copied. It's not a stock denture tooth. It's not just, as Martin likes to say, you know, we're limited maybe to only two or three styles of wax up. And he's probably right, because you have a habit, you have a signature, there's a way you do something. So every time you look at it, you try and be different, but you're kind of going to have a similar style. I'm sure Martin will know a wax up from Unica or from ourselves, Thomas, in the old days. But the thing I like about this, we have the model, we have the diagnostic, but also I can produce a shell that you saw that can be sent back. We can also produce a carrier completely digitally. There's no need to produce a model, then have the inaccuracies of things like thermoforming over it. So you can see that shell crown and you can see inside it, we've left that space to allow Martin on the day to put his implant in and actually bond that to his temporary cylinder. That workflow, if we follow this all the way through, what we offer on day one, as long as the patient likes it, is exactly what we'll give at the end. We do that with, we call them Atlantis custom base single crowns, but more excitingly for me, Bifrost bridges. You know, Martin used to say to me all the time, he's like, I want it exactly the same, exactly the same. And I was like, yes, Martin. He was like, no, Stephen, I don't think you do. I don't want anything changing. He was like, I don't want any tweaks. I don't want any artistry. I want you to follow this. I was like, okay. Now using the Bifrost bridge, we can literally clone the bridge that the patient accepted, and we can carry that all the way through the stages, as Martin showed you on one of his cases. And this is huge, because if we can do that, we get less of this. We get less remakes. We get less upset patients. That reflects well on the whole dental team. That's got to be the way forward. People are more and more time poor. It's just the way modern life is. So you cannot have that wasted chair time. Miscommunication and poor impressions are some of the biggest reasons for lab remakes. Going digital helps us massively reduce that. And we have to do that, I'm afraid, because there is a rapidly declining pool of dental technicians in the UK. The average age of the dental technician now is 56. That's the average age, which means some of us are very old indeed. And since the unfortunate recent events, a lot of laboratories have closed their doors already. But it's not just poor technicians. It's exactly the same across all of dentistry. There is a shortage of highly skilled surgeons, technicians. So actually, we need to make sure we're maximizing our efficiency and effectiveness throughout the team, because time's always been our enemy, and now it's just going to be even more so. So it's efficient. And one of the things I love about this, this really is what it's like. Sometimes people just think, well, I'll just work harder. I'll just work harder at it. I'll work harder, harder, harder. Well, no, because actually, sometimes the way you're working just isn't fit for purpose anymore. Things are rapidly changing now. And if I look at the way we used to do analog processes in the lab, I couldn't afford to do that now. I can't afford to pay highly skilled technicians and have them taking so much time to get to, in honesty, a not as good result. Digital also allows us to use unique new materials that we couldn't do in an analog workflow. So really, it's about this. It's about unleashing your potential. This is what digital dentistry will do for you and your lab. I'm lucky that we have three laboratories in the UK. They're small. They're all like this. They're all small studio type laboratories. And the reason that it's important for me to be digital is we are in Ripon and Harrogate. And the reason we get the Road World Cycling Championships and the Tour de Yorkshire is because I'm surrounded by this. So it's not particularly easy to pop. You know, it's not like being in the city where, you know, you've got a lot of great infrastructure and transport links. But it doesn't really matter, because even though I'm right out here on a daily basis, and Martin can attest to this, we work with our partner lab, Thomas, in Tenerife. He's a technician who I very highly rate, and I did not want to lose his skill set when he had to go back home for family reasons. So we were like, we need to keep you in our Nexus team. How are we going to do this? Digitally is how we're going to do it. I work with Thomas, and then I work with Cedric Rusen in Hasselt and his team, and I work with the team in Mölndal in Sweden on a daily basis. So it doesn't matter I'm in the back of beyond, in a quiet place where people only come to look at a cathedral and have a nice cream tea, then go home. You know, I am literally able to work with the most cutting edge teams using the best materials that there are. And that really is what it will do for you too, because it's your gateway to opening up, to picking and choosing the best. You know, we don't do a lot of Martin's full arch wax ups. He has an awesome team he works with in Europe who do that. And I love working with them, because now I can take that as our basis and we can proceed forward. Labs aren't trying to say they want all your work. I think it's you will look at where you add the most value, where you can be a best, strongest part of the team. And this is exactly what we do. We work very closely globally to produce the best we can. Simple things like this, clone veneer cases. These things used to be a nightmare with multiple bags of matrices trying to copy it. But as Martin used to point out, never exactly the same, because there's always like a slight edge or something. It's hard for someone to build something in ceramic. Now we mill it, we clone it. What we are going to give you back is 100% what the patient approved. This is one of the exciting things myself and Martin are going to touch on later with the Prime Scan. You can literally take the structure out of the patient. You can scan it because you saw it trimmed away all the soft tissue, and I can have that sent to me. What you're seeing here, the green, is where the are getting positive soft tissue pressure. In the time it's taken for Martin to take that bridge off, the tissue's relaxed. If I made the final bridge to that tissue position, we wouldn't have had the positive pressure that Martin wanted. So he thought, right, why don't I just scan this then? I'll scan the underside. I'll scan it. I'll send it to you. It was a masterstroke, because that now means I accurately know the tissue pressure is going to be right. This is unique to digital dentistry. And because of that, we do a lot of these. You know, I'd never heard of shells or immediate loads before I met Martin. And, you know, I've had quite the learning curve. But it means, because of the way we work, I know that when I send this back, it's 100% what Martin needs on the day when he's working with Jamie, doing those very tricky immediate load cases, because we worked it right from the beginning. He had the smile design that you're seeing here done somewhere else. I imported them in. You can see in the top right, I've digitally removed the teeth. And we've looked at where the tissue's ideally, hopefully, going to be. Then we planned everything forward. And only when Martin's had time to look at it and come back to me and say, yeah, that's right, I'm happy, then we'll produce it. So it's really, really efficient, very, very effective. But really, all of this is all about one thing. It just leads to more successful outcomes, happier patients, less wasted surgery time, less remakes for the laboratory. That's got to be the win for us all, I think. As I say, feel free to put the questions in. Myself and Martin have some exciting stuff to share with you just after Jack's finished. And I'm just going to hand you back to Jack.
Cheers, Steve. Thank you very much for that. So we are coming to a close. We said we'd finish about 8:30. So we might be pushing the time just by a couple of minutes, just so we can get through to a bit more of the Q&A and in terms of what's coming extra from Martin and Steve at the end of this. But just to add a few things before we finish. So the Prime Scan, which you saw me demonstrate from before, it's not the only intraoral scanner that Dentsply Sirona manufactures. On the screen, you can see the Prime Scan on the left. You can then see the Omnicam, which is our previous generation scanner, now fully updated with the new 2020 cart. And to the right of that, you can see the Omnicam AF, which is a cartless version. It connects to a PC at the side of your surgery. And you can see the different price ranges there. So we have a scanner for every part of the market. And to mention as well, all of our scanners are also compatible with the SureSmile Aligner system, which is Dentsply Sirona's clear aligner service for patients demanding straight teeth. And for implants, currently only large implant bridges can't be done yet with intraoral scanners, but you've heard bits about this tonight, and obviously I'm happy to say that the Prime Scan is currently pushing the limits of this, and although it's currently still a work in progress, that progress has been very positive so far, and I'd like to thank Dr. Carlos Rapulo from Spain, who has kindly shared these images with us tonight and has been happy to test it. And something that may be of interest to people watching this tonight is also the AuraCheck software, which is available for the Prime Scan, which is a patient monitoring tool. It's an incredibly handy piece of software, which will allow you to compare two different scans from different points in time. So you could scan your patient today and then in 2 years' time. And it will highlight any changes in that patient's mouth. So whether or not they've got plaque buildup, gum recession, tooth wear, tooth movements, it will highlight all of that. So really, really useful. I mean, obviously you can think about it in your head, your own head, but you know, for me, I would say patients that are potentially bruxists, to have the clear evidence in terms of where that wear is happening and to show at what level that is, even at a micron level, to show where that wear is actually happening. It's incredibly useful as a patient communication tool in that regard. And just to finish on a few very quick notes on Dents by Sirona. So for those who don't know, we are actually the largest global manufacturer of dental equipment and supplies all across the world. We currently have a total revenue of about $4 billion. That was our 2019 numbers, which is shared evenly all across the world. We're headquartered mainly in Charlotte in the US, but we manufacture most of our equipment in Germany. And in the UK, we're actually based in Weybridge in Surrey, so just outside of London, on the west side of the M25. And globally, we're a 15,000 strong team. Our purpose and mission is simply to every day empower dental professionals all across the world to provide millions of patients with better dental care and to make people smile. And we empower through innovation. We're the global technology and innovation leader in the dental industry. And we pour over $150 million a year to advance dentistry. And we currently have the largest R&D platform in the industry as well, with over 600 scientists and engineers. So we truly have a solution for every workflow and every customer need. And hopefully you've seen some examples of that this evening. We span across the digital implant workflow with solutions like Azento and Simplant, as well as we have Atlantis and InLab, but we also have our digital orthodontic workflow solutions, such as Sure Smile Aligners. So whatever the need, we have a digital and seamless solution for it. And with that, I hope you'll consider letting Dents by Sirona be the partner on your digital journey. And if any of the digital solutions or technologies are of interest to you, you can, of course, at any time book a one-on-one consultation with any of our product specialists. Simply go onto our website. If you click the orange button, and you can click per product there, and you can go through to the relevant specialist, and you can choose from the time and date through the calendar there. So our time is now coming to an end. I'd like to thank everyone for attending this evening, and I'd like to give a special thank you to Martin and Steve, our speakers for tonight. So we'll now open up for any questions. So I think we've been answering a few as they've been coming through in the chat. Let's see, we've had a couple of recent ones. So we've got a question for Martin. Martin would like to answer this one. The question is, what was the biggest challenge going digital and how did you overcome it? And what to look out for? Well, let's cover the first part first. So what was the biggest challenge going digital and how did you overcome it?
I think the biggest challenge was starting, because at the beginning, you're faced with a plethora of different scanners, a lot of information. You're unsure. You know, I remember going to a dental show, and you know, leaflets and bags and people and models and scanning, and you just come out of here and you think, oh well, I like the way that one looked, I like that the way that one held. But what really helped me was I went along and I said to my labs, okay, I'm thinking about doing this. This is a journey that we go through together. What do you recommend? And actually, that was the biggest thing, because as much as I might get this super cheap or super expensive or utterly mid-range, if my lab doesn't like to work with it, then I'm going to have to find another lab partner, because I'm not a chairside person. I send all of my work out. I don't manufacture it chairside. So I think it's finding the scanner that works for you and your laboratory in a way that will deliver you the results. And I think as part of that, having a scanner that's open, so you can export SDL files, PLY files, you can send your work anywhere you choose, should be the standard at no additional cost. I think the other part of the question was, how did I overcome it? I've explained by talking to the lab. What to look out for when going digital and choosing a scanner? I think I've talked about openness. I think speed of scan and ease of scan is important, because it's no point point. I mean, there's no point having a cheaper scanner if it takes the nurses a lot longer to scan. I want this thing to be really pick up and go and everybody can use it. Because if everyone can use it, it's going to get used a lot more. If it gets used a lot more, then I'm getting better value from it. Whereas it's not the idea that this remains in my practice, you know, in my surgery as this thing that no one shall touch until I'm there. It's a working thing. It needs to be used. So as long as everyone finds it easy to press the buttons, to find the bit, to scan around it, to send it off to the lab, the more it's used, the happier we are, because actually that's saving us money on postage, saving us money on impression material, saving us money on impression trays. All of those are, you know, a key. So, and time as well. What to look out for again, speed, ease. I think support is crucial. So, you know, the thing working and working for a long time and working well. And I think the other thing is making sure you have something that's not going to be superseded in a year or two or three, because there's nothing worse than buying a scanner, taking it back. It's a lot of money. You'll be sat there with your expensive new toy, and then a bit like the new iPhone, a new one comes out. So, you know, just looking at the right time in the investment cycle, I think is key to that. Hopefully that's answered your question, Nicola. Hopefully that's answered your questions.
Cheers for that, Martin. And that actually nicely leads me on to the next question, which looks like it's aimed towards myself. So what kind of support and training for the practice team do you provide after purchase of the scanner? To answer that, after you've purchased the scanner, so we have four different suppliers who provide our scanners. Through those guys, we offer a combination of training through their own specialists, plus either myself or Simon Hughes, who work as the CAD-CAM specialist for Dentsply Sirona. So we'd be able to do training in practice, also virtually, just depending on your preference. And then any further support you need after that, you know, we could do virtual sessions, anything really to get the practice trained up. Looks like we've had some new stuff come through. Just a few comments here. We've had somebody asking just if we could go to the price slide. So just in the interest of time, I'm just going to leave the presentation just on this slide. Go back a few more. And we'll wrap up just because I'm conscious we're just pushing past our time. So that's for Persheng Rad, who asked just for me to show that price slide there. If you can see that. Yeah. Excellent. Okay. So I'm just going to finish up here. So again, thank you very much for attending this evening. Just going to go back to the last slide. If you are interested, obviously book a one-on-one consultation through our website, but really, yeah, thank you for your time this evening. Hopefully we can see you again in one of the future events that we're holding. So we're pretty much holding one every Monday for the next few weeks. We've got one next Monday on digital aligners, I believe, one shortly after that, I think on implants. And so on, but please just stay tuned to the social media channels like Facebook and Instagram, where they'll be advertised on a weekly basis. And again, just join for free, and it'll be a mixture of different speakers and different representatives from Dentsply Sirona, so not just myself. With that, I wish you all a nice evening.
Just before you wrap up, Steve and I had some news, some exciting news we've been holding.
Oh, okay.
I think.
I think
the part that we wanted to share is that, you know, under wraps, Dentsply Sirona are working on, and it's very early days with this. It's still in beta trials, but it's, you know, this is really, really early news. A workflow for full arch implantology. And the idea of this is what you need is you need a specific type of scan body. You need to also go through a specific scan pattern with the prime scan. And with that, I need to send it to Steve and the team, and he'll explain the bits that he does. So you need a team that understands how this works, and they're able to mill full arch frameworks within Atlantis. We've been doing it for around 10 months, 12 months now, Steve?
Yeah. Working with the team in Hassel, and they've been producing these incredible structures they've always done in metal. So there is no quibble over whether or not it fits, because you know, it's not like resins that can move. These are metal verification jigs. You're getting back, Martin, and the fits we've seen have been just mind-blowing. I mean, I genuinely didn't believe it was going to be possible to do full arch bridge work. But so far, as Martin said, the results have been so, so promising. It looks like it's going to be a game changer.
Yeah. And again, if you want a little video just to show. And that's just the bridge going on, fitting absolutely passively the first time. And I think the first time this went off, I'll never forget kind of Cedric and Steve and I sharing this video one Friday night, just because we'd been working on this and trying to get to the point where, in some ways, this was the holy grail of implant dentistry for us, trying to get to the point where you could do a full arch scan, you could send it via the laboratory, there is verification involved via the metal verification jigs, and get it to the point where this could be a viable option. So this is still in testing. This is still, you know, this will be released sometime this year. We're really looking forward to working with the team in Hasselt on this. And yeah, so look out, that's a little bit of kind of a sneak preview of, I think, 2021 that we're looking for. Steve, anything to add to that?
Well, just the one last thing. I mentioned new materials, and obviously now we've got Dentsply Carbon Lucitone. You can't see that because it's the background, but basically we now are talking about serious digital dentures, stronger than traditional dentures. You know, you can drive a tractor over these things. That's what I'm excited about. I'm excited about the new materials we're about to start using to deliver superior restoration. So not as good as, clearly better. And Ashley Burns, one of the pioneering laboratories in the UK that has that, and he's willing to do that with other laboratories as well. This isn't, you know, this is all open. So I would encourage you to talk to your laboratories, get them to have the Case Connect inbox installed, and everyone can get involved in this. They don't have to bought a very expensive bit of software as you do with some of the other scanners. That's it. They're on with you. And as Martin said, that's the key, really. Keep the team you want to work with and all go on the digital journey together. I think that's going to be where you'll get the most rewarding experience. Okay. That's it for me.
Apologies, Jack. I just thought I'd come in with that.
No, thank you. No, that was really important. And you have actually just generated another you just answered David and beat me to it.
on the chat today.
Excellent. All right, guys. Thank you very much. If you're happy to wrap up, we'll call that a night. So thank you, everyone, for joining.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much,
guys. Bye-bye.